Great. We're starting, and we'll just see how it goes. I think what I would like to do is encourage you to ask questions or interrupt whenever you'd like. So, though I said I will have about 15, 20 minutes of prepared notes for each time, that doesn't mean you can't stop me or that I won't stop and ask for comments and questions as we go. And so we will keep it very informal. And I'd like to encourage you to ask whatever questions you have. If you have very basic questions or a question seems stupid to you, please ask those questions or feel free to ask them. Feel comfortable. I don't know if you will be, at the end of the session, we'll know whether you are in fact free to ask the questions, but you can feel free to ask the question because those are often the best questions, I think. And so the consequence argument, as I mentioned last time, is it's a great argument, an important argument. It is a skeptical argument. We tend to think of the future as a garden of forking paths. That's the metaphor that comes from Borges. The future is a garden of forking paths. Now, he actually meant something different from what I think we typically mean when we invoke that. He had a story called The Garden of Forking Paths, in which the various paths actually are all equally real into the future. So there are many worlds equally real ontologically. So it's kind of a temporal version of the metaphysics of David Lewis style of metaphysics about possible worlds. But I don't necessarily mean that. I just mean we tend to think of the future as branching off the past. It's a very natural picture. Let's see how this works. You know the picture. Intuitively, we think we're going along, a time is going in a vertical way, and there are various points in our lives in which we have different possibilities that branch out. We don't always have alternative possibilities intuitively. Sometimes the paths, there's just one path into the future. We're walking up the trail and there's a stone that's blocking the other paths and there's just one way forward. Even there you could say you could try and climb over the stone or you could stop for a while or, you know, and then return. So you do have alternative possibilities. But there are some cases where it seems you just have one path forward. But there are other cases in which intuitively we have more than one path into the future. Here is, I think, an important place where the phenomenology or our introspection presents us with a certain picture that I think is very natural, where we naturally, when we introspect, think that we have alternative possibilities. The consequence argument challenges this. It's a skeptical argument. It's like epistemological skepticism. We, again, naturally tend to believe that we know various things about the external world, about ourselves and about the external world. I know that there's a camera over there taking a lovely picture of me or whatever. And yet there are worries about this common sense picture that I have. And I think skeptical arguments like epistemological skepticism and the consequence argument gain their power and are interesting because not because they call all of common sense into question or they come, as it were, from a very different radical perspective and challenge our views, but they come from part of our own common sense. They come from our own perspective, but they latch on to certain parts of common sense to threaten other parts. And that's what makes them so important. Now, that's the way I think the consequence argument works. As I said, it got its name from Peter Van Inwagen, but it's been around in one form or another for millennia, and with respect to scientific explanation for hundreds of years. The consequence argument started its life as an argument for fatalism, and which Aristotle discussed in De Interpretatione. So he attributed it to certain sophists, but talked about the sea battle argument, and there are other famous fatalistic arguments. And then in the Middle Ages, the argument of a similar form was basically from God's foreknowledge. So if God exists and is in time and is essentially omniscient, then it looks like we don't have freedom to do otherwise. But in the kind of, with the rise of science, and 200-300 years ago, the main worry then shifted to a more secular worry about the possibility of scientific explanation, ruling out our freedom to do otherwise. We'll see in a second that the arguments have a similar form. Let me also say, the contemporary discussion of these arguments sometimes gets complicated and technical. Even my own articles that I gave you, the articles with Mark Revisa, are, I think, a little bit technical, a little bit regimented, though they're not as bad as some of the literature in contemporary philosophy. But I think with any great important argument, you can distill the simple engines that drive the argument, the simple ideas. The metaphor I like is if you go to see a musical, a Broadway musical or a musical play, and you can hum the tune the next day, or as you're leaving the theater, you can hum the tune, or when you're taking a shower the next morning, you can hum the tune. That's very important. If you can't, then I think that indicates that it wasn't such a great musical. I think the same is true about a philosophical argument. You should, after you read the argument, you should be able to hum the tune, as it were. You should be able to say, ah, that's the basic idea. Now, even though the details get extremely complex, I think it's important to kind of step back from the details. All right, so and that's what I'm going to try and do today. But let's just go through. I want to go through a few preliminaries. We want to look at the definition. Well, let me just back up and say, traditionally, we associate moral responsibility with control, with a certain kind of freedom that's importantly, as it were, a power that's up to the agent to exercise. It's a kind of control. And again, traditionally, there have been two important kinds of challenges to this control. One comes from causal determinism, or prior truth values, or God's foreknowledge. These are threats that raise the worry of necessity, or if there are truths about what I will do, truths in the remote past. So if it was true in the year 1000 that I would come to class today at 5 minutes late, unfortunately, at 9:35. If it really was true then, not just that I probably would, but that I would, it might seem that there's a kind of necessity attached to my choice and my behavior and that I couldn't have done otherwise. Similarly, if God, this all-powerful being, exists, and if he knew in the year 1000 that I would come to class at 9:35, that seems to impart a kind of necessity, which is such that I can't do otherwise. I mean, I can't make it the case that God didn't have that belief in the past. And I can't make it the case that God had a false belief. He's essentially omniscient, so there's a kind of necessity. Similarly with causal determinism, it seems like if determinism is true, then I have to do what I do. But then there's another famous worry, and that comes from the lack of determinism or indeterminism. And that also seems to threaten control, this time not because it raises the worry of necessity, but it raises the worry of randomness or arbitrariness. So those are the two kind of ways, roughly speaking, that our control can be challenged, one by necessity and another by a certain kind of lack of necessity that involves arbitrariness or randomness. So we'll be looking at the second worry, the worry from randomness or arbitrariness, when we look at Dirk Peraboom's chapters on indeterminism. But we'll start with the kind of traditional worries about determination and fatalism. So it's good to have at least some kind of notion of a definition or account of causal determinism to start with, and of moral responsibility. So in the reading, as you know, I note different conceptions of moral responsibility, or sorry, different ways of specifying the concept of moral responsibility. And what I said is, this was the first chapter of a book with Mark Reviews. So for the purposes of the book, we were adopting a Strawsonian conception. But I think we don't have to adopt that conception for this course. We can kind of go back and forth between different specifications of what moral responsibility is. But roughly speaking, and we'll read Peter Strawson's article and discuss it for tomorrow, but roughly speaking, the idea is we are morally responsible insofar as we are appropriate or fitting or apt targets of certain specific attitudes and activities. Yes, okay, I'll just finish that and then I'll get to you, Sophie. And the attitudes and activities are the attitudes, indignation, resentment, hatred, respect, love, gratitude, and the activities are moral praise and blame and punishment and reward. So insofar as we are apt or appropriate targets for these specific kinds of attitudes and activities, we are morally responsible. That's roughly speaking the Strawsonian idea, though there are various ways of filling it in. Okay, yes, Sophia.
Yeah, I just had a little comment on that, because it strikes me when I read your book that you seem a little bit more cognitivist than Strawson. Mm-hmm. He seems to me a little bit more expressivist, and you seem a little bit more like you think there's a fact of the matter of whether someone is an appropriate target or not.
Yes. Good. Yes, I think that's true. That's why I call this Strawsonian, but not Peter Strawson's exact view. And you'll see, I definitely am different from Peter Strawson in certain ways. And we'll read a paper in which I try and bring out some of these points. And yes, I think, unlike Strawson, see, Strawson thinks that there's no, as he would put it, prior or antecedent condition, a metaphysical condition that an agent has to meet, in virtue of meeting which, the agent is now an apt target for the reactive attitudes. Now, I, on the other hand, think the agent has to meet the condition of guidance control or acting freely and an epistemic condition. But when the agent meets those conditions, then that is the gateway, you could say, to the reactive attitude. So we have that difference. Now, it's complicated because though Strawson says there's no, as it were, prior metaphysical or freedom-relevant condition that agents have to meet, he does also say that moral responsibility depends on quality of will, so that resentment and indignation is going to be appropriate to other individuals who have either, you know, hostility toward me or indifference. So it is kind of, there are certain conditions for the appropriateness of the reactive attitudes that pertain to the quality of the will, but they aren't, as it were, metaphysical conditions so much as normative conditions.
They do line up pretty well, though, with standard excusing conditions and sort of excusing conditions that your reasoned responsiveness accounts for.
Yeah.
So there's an internal logic to resentment. When is resentment appropriate? Well, resentment is appropriate when you've expressed ill will toward me. Well, when do you do that? You do that when you control your behavior in light of your judgments about how to act.
So there will be. I think there.
Two different things.
Yeah, there will be relationships. And so, in other words, I think it's a mistake to think. So some people think that Peter Strawson thinks, let's say you look at a culture or a society and you try and figure out what moral responsibility is, and moral responsibility just is this set of practices. And when people have indignation or resentment, that indicates, I mean, there's no further fact about whether the indignation or the resentment is appropriate. There's no further logic to it. But, you know, I think part of his theory emphasizes quality of will considerations, and so there would be a further logic. It's not just given, as it were. Yep. Go ahead, Sophia.
Yeah, no, I didn't have that much more to say. I think, I think there is some kind of perhaps phallic sophisticated expressivism going on. So,
yes.
So there's no moral realist fact about moral responsibility.
Right.
We express our attitudes, but that doesn't mean that we express them willy-nilly, like, oh,
right.
Suddenly I felt resentment, and that
exactly.
means you're moral.
So it's an expressive, you're right, expressive, a certain kind of non-cognitivism is consistent with not arbitrariness or willy-nilly expect. But let's, what I want to say, I don't want to go too far into this now, we'll look at Strawson's article tomorrow, but I just wanted to say, roughly speaking, you could think of moral responsibility as aptness for these distinctive attitudes and activities, and that would then distinguish us from mere animals. And it would, let me also say, obviously, that you could think of moral responsibility in slightly different ways. You could think of it as just aptness for moral judgments in general, like right and wrong. And so we think that human beings and persons generally can sometimes act rightly, sometimes act wrongly, and can have certain moral virtues like courage, courage, cowardice, resilience, and so forth. Resilience might be something animals could have. We don't think, though, that mere animals can be, let's say, can act rightly or wrongly, I think. I mean, when the lion eats the lamb, it's not acting wrongly, even if it causes a lot of pain. We don't make those kinds of, it's inappropriate to make these moral assessments of animals. So another way of thinking of moral responsibility is the individuals who are morally responsible are the ones that are accessible to or appropriate targets for moral judgments or attributions of moral properties, characteristics. This, I think, is a metaphor is sometimes the ledger. So it's sometimes called the ledger view that we have moral ledgers, whereas an animal doesn't. I mean, this is just kind of oversimplified, of course. And then there, another idea of moral responsibility, another way of saying what moral responsibility is, what the concept of responsibility is the accountability idea. So you think of responsibility as a kind of accountability, an agent that's responsible, at least in principle, or you could say must be capable of providing an account of his or her behavior. So it's kind of a pun here, I suppose, because responsibility is a kind of accountability, but here the idea is that the individual could give an account, an explanation or an account of its behavior. Again, the lion can't give an account of its eating the lamb, it just eats the lamb. So in any case, these are different ways of specifying the concept of responsibility. And I want to kind of remain neutral here for now as to which one is the best. I will often slip into the Strawsonian way of specifying it. It's this idea that we are unlike other creatures, mere animals, let's say. Though, of course, there could be sophisticated extraterrestrials and who are morally responsible. That's certainly a possibility. And maybe computers of the future could be sophisticated enough that we'd want to say they are in control, they are responsible, they are conscious. None now, perhaps. I want to leave that open. And possibly there are some higher primates that you'd want to say, in a limited sense, are morally responsible. I would like to leave that open. But okay, so traditionally, though, as I say, and it's natural to think this way, there's some kind of control condition on moral responsibility. The creatures that are the moral creatures, or the ones that can provide explanations, or the ones that are apt targets for the reactive attitudes, have to have a kind of control. Now, causal determination has been thought to threaten that kind of control. So where was my definition of causal determinism? I have it on page 14. I give to Mark and I, who's now a Jesuit priest in the Philippines and still thinking about moral responsibility but not writing about it. We have this, we say, kind of in the middle there of page 14. And I'm sorry, I think I'm going to be talking a little bit more today than usual, but laying out some of these basic ideas. But here, what we say is causal determinism is the thesis that for any given time, a complete statement of the facts about that time, together with a complete statement of laws of nature, entails every truth as to what happens after that time. Now, this is really simplified, and what I want to say is, this is a little bit misleading. What I really would want to say is, whatever causal determinism is, and it's really hard to give a really adequate account of causal determinism. There's a book by John Ehrman called, I think it's on determinism, and he goes through various possibilities, and it's very complex. It gets very complex very quickly. Maybe for our purposes, this is enough. Whatever else causal determinism is, it will imply this. It implies that for any given time, a complete statement of the facts about that time, together with a statement of the laws of nature, entail all facts about the future. And this is a one-way determinism. You can have two-way determinism. So whatever else determinism is, it will have this implication, and that will be enough for us to work with it. There's an alternative way of putting it here. David Lewis suggested this, I think. I don't know if he was the first one, but causal determinism obtains in a possible world W, just in case any possible world that shares a time slice with W and has the same natural laws as W is identical with W. So that's a possible world's way of putting the causally deterministic thesis. The intuition is, if this world, let's say, if a particular world, our world or any world, is deterministic, then any apparently different world or any world that shares a time slice with our world and all the laws of nature will be identical to our world. It won't branch off. It has to be the same. So that's a possible world's way of putting the definition. Yeah, Matt.
Would that kind of determinism go in both directions, into the past and the future? Because you could,
yes,
the time slice could,
that's a two-way.
Right?
Yeah, that's a two-way. And we could make, that's a good point, and we could make the first definition two-way. We could say, causal determinism is the thesis that for any given time, a complete statement of the facts about that time, together with a complete statement of laws of nature, entails every truth about every time. You know, even so that would be a two-way determinism. But for our purposes, I think for the one-way determinism is the main worry. Sophia?
Yeah, shouldn't it be logically possible that you have two possible worlds that are completely identical and also completely identical laws of nature, but they had different starting conditions and that was slightly different histories, and then they became precisely the same?
I'm sorry, so which, I'm sorry, could you repeat that?
Yeah, it seems that it would be logically possible that you have two universes. They have precisely the same laws of nature. The starting conditions are slightly different, so they're going to be slightly different and have slightly different histories, but at one point they converge and become precisely the same.
Okay, and so that would be...
So in that case, the definition wouldn't be two-way.
So, yeah, so in other words, that what you're suggesting, let me see, are you suggesting that that possibility shows that the second definition really isn't a two-way?
Yeah, that's was my idea.
Are you suggesting that maybe the overlap is just brief, they just sort of cross, you know, they're going along on their trajectories, and then one time slice, they're identical, but then they diverge again?
No,
in which case it wouldn't be.
They would follow each other after that point.
No, so
no, maybe I'm confused here.
No.
Don't listen to me.
I have to listen to you.
Okay,
no, I agree with Sophia that the second addition of the way back, I mean, it needs to be proved additionally.
Okay,
so I think this is what's going on here. It really is, I think, true that, I might be wrong, but I think that second definition is an attempt to capture two-way determinism. In other words, causal determinism obtains in a possible world W, just in case any possible world which shares a time slice with that world W and has the same natural laws as W is identical with W. I mean, it's not saying, so that's an attempt to capture something a bit stronger than the first definition. That was misleading in Mark Revisa in my presentation. But you're right, you could you could adjust this to just capture one-way determinism to, and it is logically possible, I think, that you have a world, a scenario of the sort you envisage. What you're saying is, it seems at least logically possible, and probably metaphysically possible, to have determinism that kicks in, you know, at a certain point, and that the universe is deterministic from that point on, but wasn't deterministic before. But that would, this is a stronger idea. This is two-way determinism. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I guess so. It was just a small aside because I don't think it's going to matter.
But we can think about that. There are, well, here's the bottom line. There are lots of different conceptions of determinism. One would be kind of this very strong two-way determinism. But really, I think the worries for causal, the worries for free will come from the idea that the past together with the laws require me to act as I do. So it's that one way. I'm not so concerned about whether my actions now force a certain past, but what I'm worried about is whether the past and the laws force a certain action. So yeah, Yishai?
I was wondering about, on both of these definitions of determinism, whether it gets the right verdict with respect to possible worlds where there is a single time slice. These views entail that any possible world with a single time slice is, by definition, a deterministic world.
Yeah. Oh, very good question. And I don't know what to say. In other words, there are going to be all sorts of difficult questions. Like, in other words, we can imagine a universe with just one time, right? It just pops into being and goes out of existence very quickly. Not a very exciting world, but
it's at least not obvious to me that one couldn't act freely. If one has like these libertarian intuitions, it's not obvious to me that from the get-go that we're gonna.
Well, see that. So this, I think, I want to probably put aside some of these thought experiments. But I think if you just have one instant, there's not even going to be the possibility of action at all. If it's a duration, then if the time slice is some kind of duration, then I think you might be able to have, in principle, action. But even then, you might think certain historical conditions have to be met, you know, before you actually have an agent or you have freedom, at least. So it's kind of tricky. But that is, it's just an interesting point that if we can imagine a universe with just one time, these definitions do seem to imply that that's a deterministic universe, right? But I don't know how much hangs on it for freedom, but it is interesting. I mean, some of Joseph Campbell's work on the consequence argument raises some of these questions. Go ahead.
But shouldn't it be determined in that moment that this world will not come in, this world will not be there next moment?
Yeah, it might or might not be determined. In other words, you could just imagine, it's very odd. It's not so simple to imagine a point, a temporal point-like universe that comes into being and then goes out of being, like a little flash. And so what you're wondering is, but I mean, I'm not sure whether we have to think of it as determined that it will go out of being. It might just come into being and go out of being in an indeterministic way.
I was thinking about the answer to that question. If this world, which exists only one moment, would be a deterministic world.
Yeah.
And I guess not, because, I guess not. If it's not determined, it will disappear next moment.
Yeah, it's just really puzzling, because we tend to think that determinism is about the relationship between the past and what happens now. But in a point like universe, there's no past at all, so it's not clear how to think of that. But I think, I mean, we're not typically, what I think we are worried about is, you know, sometimes, let me just say, this is a digression for those of you who know some of the literature on the Joseph Campbell worries about the consequence argument, but it's just a simple point that I think we come to these problems worrying about or wondering whether we in this world are morally responsible. And one of our real worries is maybe determinism is true in this world. But manifestly, this world is not a point-like world and does have a past, a remote past. So really what we're mainly concerned about are contexts in which there is a remote past, and we're asking what the relationship between that past and the present is. I mean, now, some people might find that a little bit complacent analytically, and but that's the way I think. I mean, I think we're really worried about whether we're responsible in a world like ours, in our world. All right, so how does the consequence argument threaten us? Let's just go to, let's see. I think I have it on page 20, the informal presentation. I mean, this is what I call the modal version, and you'll see. Okay, so it's just on page 20. And it's very simple, really. We have certain parts of common sense. And one part is that the past is fixed and over and done with. I have no control over the past. I can't so act that John F. Kennedy would not have been assassinated in Dallas, Texas. I can't now act in such a way that the Spanish Armada would not have been defeated. Not that I care about that. But you know, the past is over and done with. I don't have it in my power to do anything about it. Similarly, the laws of physics or the laws of nature, they don't have to just be laws of physics, but some people think they're all reducible to the laws of physics, some people don't, but the laws of nature are outside of my control. Again, that's not everyone's going to agree with that. Kind of Humean about the laws of nature is going to disagree, but there's just some common sense intuition that the laws bind me, that I don't write the laws. They don't bend to me, but I bend to the laws. So if I have no control over the past and I don't have any control over the laws and causal determinism is true, then it seems like I don't have any control over my behavior. That's the idea. And one way of regimenting it a little bit more carefully is in terms of this transfer of powerless principle. This is why the argument is a modal argument, that it uses, see, Van Inwagen in his work called it principle beta, the principle of transfer of powerlessness, or what I call it the principle of transfer of powerlessness. Principle beta is the name that Peter Van Inwagen gave it. But the idea is, roughly speaking, if I'm powerless over one thing, and I'm powerless over the fact that that leads to another thing, then I'm powerless over the other thing. Okay, if I put in terms of Van Inwagen's terminology, if I have no choice over one thing, and I have no choice over the fact that that leads to another, then I have no choice over the other. It's a transfer of powerlessness. And intuitively, the way this applies, if causal determinism is true, then the past and the laws entail that I behave as I do. If I have no choice about the past, and I have no choice about the fact that the past leads to my behavior, then I have no choice over my behavior. That's the intuition. That's the tune that you can hum. I mean, it's a very natural idea. And I just regimented a little bit more, slightly more, on page 21, where this is a kind of power necessity, NSTB. So, I mean, the idea is, I'll just go through it and then we'll start. Bottom of page 20, put slightly more rigorously, the argument can be stated as follows. Given that causal determinism obtains, there's some statement of the condition of the world at some past time, T1, that statement is B, which together with the laws of nature entails that the agent does A at T3. Since nobody has control over the past, it's necessary, it's power necessary for the agent at T2, that B was true at T1. And since nobody has control over the laws of nature, it's power necessary that if that was true in the past, then the agent behaves as he does. And if we use the transfer principle, it follows that it's power necessary for the agent that he acts as he does. This is this very basic modal principle. That's why it gets the name, it gives the argument the version, the, its name, the modal version. And it works like this. This is a kind of necessity that's not logical necessity, it's power necessity for an agent S at a time T. And the idea is that if something P, I'm being very rough here, but something P is power necessary for the agent at T, that's out of his control or her control. And so that's the first premise, that's one. Then two is, if it's power necessary for S at T, that P implies Q, then it follows that it's power necessary for S at T, that Q. And really, this is just a regimentation of the intuitive idea that if one thing is out of my control, and it's out of my control that that thing leads to another, then the other thing is outside of my control. And you can see how that then gets used in the consequence argument. The idea is the past is out of my control. That gives you the first premise. The second premise comes from the fact that the laws of nature are out of my control. So P implies Q is an instance of a law of nature or entailed by the laws of nature. So it follows that Q is outside of my control. And this is, you know, one, I just want just a brief aside here. I said there are many ways in which the consequence argument, being an argument for free will skepticism that challenges ordinary views of common sense, is similar to epistemological skepticism. But this is just one way. Let me just point out one way, is the epistemological skeptic, the Cartesian epistemological skeptic, often uses a modal principle of exactly this form. But her principle is not pertaining to power necessity, but epistemic necessity or knowledge. So this is essentially the same as the principle of closure of knowledge under known entailment. So if S knows that P, and S knows that P implies Q, then S knows that Q, right? So that's the principle of closure of knowledge under known entailment. Not under entailment, but under known entailment. So if someone knows that P and someone knows that P implies Q, then she knows that Q. And that's, when you think about it, that's the argument that underlies Cartesian skepticism about the external world, because the idea is, if I know that there's a camera over there, so let's say I do know that there's a camera over there, I also know that if there is a camera over there, then I'm not being deceived by an evil demon into merely thinking that there's a camera over there, or I'm therefore it follows that I know that I'm not being deceived by an evil demon to think that there's a camera over there when there really isn't. But what the epistemological skeptic is going to say is, I don't know that. I don't know and can't know that I'm not being deceived by an evil demon. So given that, you go back, you work backwards to the conclusion that I don't know that there's a camera over there. Now, we don't have to, I don't really want to spend a lot of time on the epistemological skeptical's argument. All I want to do is just point out, this modal principle is structurally the same. The modal principle about power necessity that's used in Van Inwagen's principle beta or my principle of transfer of powerlessness is really the same abstractly as the closure of knowledge under known entailment. And many of the moves in the two debates are very similar. There is an interesting literature on the relationship between the consequence argument and epistemological skepticism about the, Cartesian skepticism about the external world. And actually, Joe Campbell is one example of someone who's written about it. My former student, Garrett Pendergraft, has written about the relationships. Okay. Is there any question about what? Let me just stop and say, okay, that's the modal argument. That's the modal argument, the modal version of the consequence argument. And there are different, I mean, some people forget when they're thinking about the consequence argument. How are we doing on time? Well, we're doing fine. They forget that there are different versions of this argument. And that's going to be something that we're going to discuss next. But this is often thought to be the mother version or the Ur version, the basic version of the consequence argument. I'm not sure why exactly. I mean, Peter Van Inwagen kind of, I think, gave this as his first version of the argument, the modal version, using the transfer principles and kind of transferring the necessity from the past and the laws to the present. I think Tim O'Connor used the metaphor of a modal slingshot. It's like a slingshot that's slinging necessity from the past and the laws into the present and the future. I promise you that we'll get to other versions of the argument, but a lot of attention has been placed on this modal version. Let me also just point out historical point. It's not just that the arguments have been around in structurally similar form for millennia, but in contemporary philosophy, I think the first version of the consequence argument, regimented roughly in this way, was presented by David Wiggins. And then Carl Genet, Cornell philosopher, who then was actually at Rochester, presented this. And Peter Van Inwagen was actually a student at Rochester who heard Carl Genet's lectures. And Peter Van Inwagen was very much influenced by Genet's way of formulating the argument. So there were antecedents even in contemporary philosophy to Peter Van Inwagen. But I think Van Inwagen gets a lot of credit for writing it up and presenting it in a very compelling way. I mean, he's a better writer in many ways than Carl Genet and David Wiggins, and so he really presented it in a compelling, interesting way that gave it. And one important kind of feature of these contemporary regimentations is they make it clear that the argument is of this form. Sorry, I'm talking a lot, but you know, this is kind of an unusual day for that purpose. But it's got this form and not the obviously fallacious form, because a lot of people think that fatalist arguments and then maybe the consequence argument have to be of a problematic form. Now, yeah, this is for some of you. You'll be like practicing some yoga positions to try and read the. But in any case, what I want to say is, there's this form. And then there's this very bad form, which we're going to say this is not a good form. Let's see, one star would be would just be P. And then two would be N, necessity S, T, P implies Q, and then Q. So it's P, like the past. I mean, something happened in the past. John F. Kennedy was assassinated in Dallas, November 22nd, 1963. Then it's necessary for S at T that if that happened, then so-and-so, you know, I raise my hand. Therefore, we conclude, we conclude Ness S T Q. This is fallacious because I mean, it's just a modal fallacy, and we could go through various counterexamples. We don't have to go from P, necessary P implies Q, to necessary Q. What you need is necessity here. You can't just have P. You need necessary P. And then you can use this a general, you know, transfer principle or principle beta that says necessary P implies Q, necessary Q. I mean, here, think of this. Would this be at all plausible that if P is true, and then you also know that S knows that P implies Q, that you could conclude that S knows that Q? No, that's obviously a problem, because if S doesn't know that P, just because she knows that P implies Q, doesn't follow that she knows that Q. So you need the epistemic necessity there. Epistemic necessity or knowledge. Similarly, you need the necessity here. You can't just have P. So people thought in the past that you could easily dismiss the consequence argument, just like you could dismiss arguments for fatalism and God's foreknowledge, they thought, because they were instances of this fallacy, this modal fallacy. They had to be of this form. But people like Wiggins and Janae and Van Inwagen and others show, no, they don't have to be of that form, because they can be of this form, and the way they get to be this form is the past has a kind of necessity. And to use Occam's term, accidental necessity, or I mean, as we go along, now, this morning when I woke up, it wasn't part of the past that I would come to a lecture at 9:35. But now it is part of the past that I came to lecture at 9:30, so it's a kind of accidental or contingent necessity that changes. But that necessity is gives you this first premise, according to the incompatible. So that's one reason why these contemporary formulations are really important. Okay, so let me stop. Any questions or comments on the modal version of the transfer principle? Is it clear, or is it, ask me anything about what, whether it's unclear, what it's doing, or where you could even say if you think there's some obvious problem with it.
Isn't that the version that people made a counterexample to with coin flips, so that Van der Wagen made some little modification to account for that?
Yes. So there are, okay, good.
Maybe you were getting to that.
No, well, I was kind of gonna get to that, but it's a good point that this is a very simple version of the argument. And so one thing that's happened, and this is a very good question, it's a good segue also to what I want to talk about with respect to the different versions, but you can, I don't want to go through the details of the examples and the counterexamples and the way people have reacted, but there are, I think, counterexamples or arguably counterexamples to this principle beta. And there are counterexamples involving kind of coin flips and random events and quantum mechanic random events. And the details of those counterexamples to the principle don't really matter to us here, because so there are different ways people have gone. So let me just say, Sophia's quite right. We have this principle. We could simplify. Well, this is the principle that, so here, it's box. We use boxes, if you like boxes. Necessary at T for S that P. Necessary T, P implies Q. Therefore, necessary S, T, Q. So this is principle beta. I always have trouble doing a beta. My Greek letters are, I can't do it. But anyway, this is beta, and or what I call principle of transfer of powerlessness. So PTP, the slingshot that goes, it slingshots necessity from this to this via this. Okay, so long story short, various philosophers looked at Van Inwagen's and Janae's arguments and said, okay, this is progress. Now we see these arguments are not instances of this bad inference pattern. This is not obviously a fallacy. But when you think about it carefully, it turns out that in certain contexts, and I just don't like contexts in which philosophers point to quantum mechanical phenomena and say, this is a counterexample. I mean, I know it's perfectly fair intellectually, but for some reason I don't like this. But let me say, that doesn't matter whether I like them or not. They're perfectly reasonable critiques of this principle. So, but then I think what the story, the way the story goes is then various philosophers just revised this principle to make it a little more complex in a way that it gets around the counterexamples and then also still has the implication that, you know, is needed for the consequence argument. So, for instance, there's a discussion in Tim O'Connor's book. Tim O'Connor's book, what is it, Persons and Causes, something like that, in which he goes through the counterexamples to this principle and he says, but still we could then adjust the principle in such a way that it's now immune to the counterexamples and it still can be used in the consequence argument. And then, you know, you can go back and forth. Other proposed counterexamples are brought forward, and if you think those really are counterexamples, then there are ways of adjusting it further. And then we get into the debate then becomes kind of tricky because originally we started with something simple, or fairly simple, and we thought that had an intuitive power. Once you then, and this happens a lot in philosophy, right? We have some simple idea, and we say, that's intuitive, the past is fixed, or that's intuitive. If you're powerless over one thing and you're powerless over that thing's leading to another, then you're powerless over the other. Like, if I haven't fixed my roof at all right now, and today, let's say I'm powerless over whether lightning hits it because I can't control the weather. I wish I could, but I can't control the weather. So I'm powerless over the fact that the lightning hits my roof. And because I haven't fixed it, I haven't prepared it or anything, I'm powerless over the fact that if a lightning bolt hits my roof, then there will be a fire in my house. It does seem to follow that I'm powerless over the fact that there's going to be a fire, I mean, in my house. I could have done something to protect the roof in the previous months, but given that I haven't done, I can't control the weather, and so I can't control that there will be a fire in my house. That's an intuitive idea. Now, if people start saying, but if you regiment that general principle, we can come up with counterexamples. Now you say, okay, well, then I can adjust the principle. And then someone else says, but now, once you adjust it in that way, there'll be counterexamples. And you say, I can adjust it in a different way. Now you're moving away from that simple idea, and we're not sure that it's powerful anymore or that we can still believe. So that's one problem, I think, with this avenue. But there's another. Let me just say, Sophia brings up a really important point, and I think it's important because, partly because my view is even if there are decisive counterexamples to this principle, since the argument really doesn't need this principle, we don't really have to give up the consequence argument, even if there are decisive counterexamples to principle this transfer principle. That's an important. I mean, if I'm right that there are other versions of the argument that don't use this principle at all, then we wouldn't have to worry about the fact that there are counterexamples. And you know, I think people have gotten gotten hot and bothered about whether there are counterexamples to principle beta. And there's a whole huge literature about this. You know, there are counterexamples. And then people say, no, they really aren't counterexamples. Or they are, but we can adjust the principle. My thinking is, yeah, that's interesting, but you really don't need to go down that road because there are versions of the argument that don't use that. Now, it's a bit controversial because, I mean, definitely controversial because other people would think, no, Fisher and Ravis are wrong. If you think carefully enough, you'll see that every version of the argument depends on the principle, and then it would be a big deal if they're counterexamples. But did you want to follow up on that? Yep.
No.
Okay, Dimitri.
Yes, I think Dennett offers an interesting analogy for consequent argument. He says that every mammal has a mammal for a mother, and if there have been any mammals at all, there have been only a finite number of mammals. Mm-hmm. But if there has been even one mammal, then There have been an infinity of mammals, which contradicts the point, and so there can't be any mammals. So he thinks that's a fallacious. It seems that you really can speak here about the mammalianism, the transfer of mammalianism principle, which kind of looks to me similar to this beta principle, or maybe even not just beta, but to the wider intuition that is the foundation.
So let me say this again, and I want to be reminded of that. Let me just say, Dennett thinks that the consequence argument is not sound. It's not a sound argument, and he, together with a colleague or a student or colleague, I forget his name, maybe someone remembers. But anyway, he's written a couple articles criticizing the consequence argument, saying that it's not sound. And I don't remember the details, but he's among a group of philosophers who wants to defend a kind of classical compatibilism against the consequence argument, and there are, so he has a specific version, and so. But my own, like I say, I would say that even if the transfer principle is invalid, so even if there is a counterexample, and like I say, some people, I think McKay at Syracuse was one of the first, didn't he? Do you know that is there
McKay and Johnston?
Yeah, McKay and Johnston had a counterexample to the principle that invoked these random phenomena, and I think others then followed. David Whitaker had one, I think. And but then there's also a way of arguing, perhaps what Dennett is suggesting is there's an analogy between the transfer principle and an obviously fallacious form of reasoning, and therefore we should be suspicious of the transfer principle. And again, I think it becomes really complicated and really unclear what to say, because again, with McKay and Johnston's counterexamples and Whitaker's and others, proponents of the consequence argument have just adjusted the principle to, and they've argued that you can adjust the principle in a way that still makes it compelling and in a way that allows you to get around the counterexamples. And you might do the same, in light of the analogy that Dennett was bringing forth. But there's this other way of thinking. I prefer this other way. It's I'm not really sure if the transfer principle is valid. It might or might not be, but we don't really need it. That's my view, that we can do it without the transfer principle. And we're going to get to that argument. I think there's a simpler argument suggested by Carl Janay and even Peter Van Inwagen. But other comments on? Yes, Simon.
You characterize it as this skeptical argument. Yeah. Do you think that characterization only works if you give more credence to the thought that we don't know whether causal determinism is true, as compared with the thought that we don't know whether the ability to do otherwise is the right control condition?
Yes, I think. So in other words, a good point. It's a skeptical argument, really, that we should take note of and be concerned about only if we really don't know whether determinism is false or true. I mean, in other words, if we were quite confident that determinism is false, then we really wouldn't have to worry about this. I mean, it could still be of intellectual interest. It could be kind of like a logical exercise or of intellectual interest, but it wouldn't be really pressing or as worrisome. So I've been assuming that the jury is out about whether determinism is true. Was that what you were wondering
about? Yeah, kind of, but I guess what, so the question, so you could start out like that, right? I don't know whether it's true.
Yeah.
Here's an argument that says, according to these two principles of common sense, it should be false.
Right.
Therefore, it is false.
Yeah, or even three principles. I'm saying the principle of fixity of past, fix the laws and the transfer principle. Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
But and the fact that we are morally responsible,
yes,
and this is the control condition, therefore it must be false, rather than to get the skeptical conclusion, you have to hold fixed to the fact that we just don't know whether causal determinism is true.
Yes.
As in, you can't let the argument teach us that it's false.
Yeah, well, you could. I agree that there are different moves you can make once you see the argument. So, in other words, we have this argument in place, and it seems it uses some elements of common sense, and then we could go in different directions. And one direction would be to rethink these principles, like the fixity of the past and the fixity of laws. That's what, or the transfer principle. Sophia points out some people have rethought the transfer principle, and they say, no, they're counterexamples. Some people have rethought the fixity of the past, and some people rethink the fixity of laws, and so David Lewis, Keith Lehrer, there are various John Perry classical compatibilists who want to reject these principles. But then another way to go would be to say, well, there must be some way of crystallizing the intuition that the past is fixed and regimenting it or articulating it into a principle, and some way of crystallizing and regimenting the fixity of the laws such that we do have a valid argument. And this just shows that determinism must be false. Okay, and that because we know that we are free in the sense of free to do otherwise. Now, I myself don't like that strategy or find it unappealing, because I think we shouldn't be able to know from our armchairs whether the determinism is true or false. That is an empirical, issue that will be decided by science. And now, not straightforwardly by science, but it should be just a scientific question. I mean, I think ultimately, if we get a scientific theory that over time is perfect in its predictions, we will probably come to think that is a true determinist. And I mean, it's perfect and it predicts everything comprehensively. Its models are deterministic. That's probably the way we could, in principle, empirically just ascertain that determinism was true. But it shouldn't, in my view, what I think is problematic is to say, I have this philosophical argument, and it shows that if determinism is true, we wouldn't be free. But we obviously are free, so we must conclude that determinism is false. I mean, it should be an empirical matter. At least that's one infelicity in that strategy. Does that make sense? Or?
Yeah, that makes sense.
Okay, some sense. Peter Van Inwagen himself, he had a different approach, which I think is also problematic. What he said was, so this argument is a valid argument. So he thinks if determinism is true, then we wouldn't be free in the relevant sense, the sense that grounds responsibility. And then he says, but he thinks it's obvious that we are free, so he concludes that indeterminism is true. But he says, if in the future he were convinced that determinism is true, he would not give up the view that we're free. He'd give up principle beta, and therefore he would be, in that circumstance, a compatibilist. So this is what I call, I called it pejoratively, intentionally pejoratively, metaphysical flip-flopping, because what I said was, this seems a little weird to me that you say, because some empirical thesis turns out to be true, I'm going to go back and change my basic metaphysical views, basically in order to save my idea that we are free. So I find that problematic, metaphysical flip-flopping. I've written a paper recently trying to explain more what the problem there is. But so I myself, let me just say, my preferred strategy, for whatever it's worth, and it doesn't matter so much, but just to put it on the table, I think the consequence argument is pretty good. I'm not sure that it's valid, and I don't think it's a knockdown argument, but in some form or another, I think it's a powerful argument. So I think I do think we are free and morally responsible. So I want to say we're free in a sense that doesn't require alternative possibilities. So that's the way I go. And I think that's a better way to go. But of course, I would think it. I mean, just like we all think our own babies are the prettiest ones, you know, at some level, we could probably reflect and say, no, probably the other babies are just as pretty. But I think there's something to be said for that way of going. Now, what's problematic, of course, is I have to say, we can be free and responsible even though we couldn't have done otherwise, and all sorts of other things. Okay, Dan.
Yeah, I was just thinking about what you were saying about Van den Wagen. When he says, if I found out that determinism were true, right? So at the end of the essay, he sort of lists certain commitments he has in order of his credence level.
Yes.
And so I think the first one is not so much that we have the freedom to do otherwise, but rather that we are sometimes morally responsible.
Yes.
So, and maybe I'm misremembering the order in which he lists things, but he doesn't, depending on how he lists them, he doesn't need to be committed into giving up beta. He could be committed to giving up PAP, for example.
Yes. So this is a good point. So what Van Inwet, so it is, it's one thing that's really interesting is just to go through the nitty gritty of the consequence argument and figure out, is this sound, is this valid? And you know, Dennett and others have done this in an interesting way. There's a whole literature on it. But then there's another thing that's, I think, even more interesting is, like, if it turned out that it is a sound argument, or it's not obviously not sound, what are you going to do about it? Like, what are the implications? Are you going to conclude, determinism must be false? Are you going to conclude, well, then we're not really morally responsible at all? Or are you going to conclude, well, it turns out you don't need freedom to do otherwise to be morally responsible? So, I mean, there are all these different views. Or, you know, are you going to be a classical compatibilist and say, although the elements of the argument seemed to you intuitive, it turns out there's a problem. You know, David Lewis was definitely a smart, smart guy and a brilliant, penetrating philosopher. And what he said is, well, you know, there are different ways of understanding the fixity of the past, and yes, in some ways of understanding the fixity of the past, turns out it really is true that the past is fixed, but on those ways, those specific ways, you don't get the incompatibilist conclusion. But, you know, and then if you specify a way of capturing the fixity of the past that's strong enough to get the incompatibilist conclusion, it will turn out it's not obviously true that the past is fixed that way. So it's, you know, it's this really delicate. So there is the classical compatibilist move. But okay, so but what Dan said was, so Peter Van Inwagen says at the end of his book, look, I'm committed to these different things. And my first commitment is that we're sometimes morally responsible. That's an important commitment. I don't think he's committed to, I mean, I think he says in a footnote earlier in the book that if we were to discover that we were being manipulated by Martians, unbeknownst to us, Martians had put, when we were born, little chips into our brain and were manipulating us secretly, he said, well, if he found that out, then he would conclude we're not morally responsible. So I guess he doesn't think we're morally responsible no matter what discovery we made, but his first priority is that we are morally responsible sometimes. But then, I don't know what exactly is next on the list, but pretty high on the list is morally responsible entails could have done otherwise. So that's the principle of alternative possibility. And he does defend that principle against Frankfurt. So he puts that pretty high. Then, below that is the different, I mean, well, I forget where the fixity of the past and the fixity of laws come. They're pretty high up. But among the principles that are the basic ingredients, the transfer of powerlessness comes at the bottom for him. So that's why he's willing to say, look, I don't think I'll ever be convinced that determinism is true. But if in the future, you know, in the very unlikely scenario that scientists convince me that determinism is true, I would not give up my first priority that we're responsible, nor would I give up the idea that responsibility requires freedom to do it. I would give up principle beta. So I think it's much more, so, but to me, this is a dialectically uncomfortable position to be in. That is, even though, I just want to say, Van Inwagen, of course, defends principle beta. He doesn't actually give it up. But he is committed to this hypothetical or counterfactual. He's committed to giving it up were he to be convinced that determinism is true. And I just think that's dialectically uncomfortable. I mean, I'll get to you in a second. Okay, Yishai. But I mean, to me, it's like, but you know, they're difficult philosophical, methodological issues here. But think about utilitarianism as an ethical theory. Often it's pointed out that, well, in certain circumstances, you as a utilitarian would have to say, torturing someone, an innocent person, is morally permissible. Indeed, that's what you ought to do. If that's the way, or breaking a promise, you know, doing something morally, intuitively terrible, that's what you as a utilitarian would have to say. And the utilitarian typically is going to respond by saying, ah, but what assumptions are you making? To force me to say that they're very implausible assumptions. I mean, it's not really plausible in the real world that that would maximize utility, torturing someone. Well, I mean, what if people found out, breaking a promise? Well, then, you know, again, like in most debates, it gets complicated. But the critic's going to come back and say, wait a second, I can at least imagine certain circumstances where you could completely keep it a secret that you've broken this promise or that you've tortured this person or whatever. And it would really, in that circumstance, it really would maximize utility. So there you'd have to say it. And, you know, often the utilitarian will just say, okay, I mean, I grant you that it's at least possible that I'd have to say that, but it's really, really unlikely. And my theory is built for the real world and plausible assumptions. So just because I would be committed to this result in an unlikely scenario, that doesn't really threaten me. I'm still comfortable. But then, you know, you might worry. You might say, look, that's pretty complacent. That the fact that you are at least committed to torturing an innocent person in admittedly an unlikely scenario seems to indicate there's something wrong with your theory. It seems that you're onto something. You're not latching on to what's morally basic. There's something really problematic. And I think something similar is true of Van Inwagen. I mean, the fact that he's committed to giving up this basic metaphysical principle in the unlikely event that he were convinced that determinism is true, it seems to show there's something wrong with his actual views. I don't have to do that. If I were convinced that determinism is true, I don't know if determinism is true or not. Nothing in my view depends on whether it is or isn't. And because I don't think you need that kind of freedom to be morally responsible. Okay, Yishai, did you?
Yeah, so respect to the utilitarian case, I mean, we might say that the utilitarian is rationally criticizable in the sense that here's a counterexample to their view. But I'm not sure if there's any sort of counterexample with Van Inwagen's position. It doesn't seem like he's rationally criticizable in any way, right? He has his credence in all these propositions, and it turns out that determinism is true, that's exactly what he should do. He should give up beta. It's unsatisfying, and we don't want to be in that position where we might have to change our view, but unlike the utilitarian case, it's not obvious that Van Wagen is rationally criticizable for his position.
Okay.
Yeah, and just to follow up, it seems that maybe he would be, so first I do agree with you, maybe he would be rationally criticizable if it weren't the case that he thinks he has better reason or stronger reason to commit himself to the view that we are moral, at least sometimes morally responsible, than to the view that beta is true or that PAP is true or something. So if he feels like, if he has further commitments or further reasons to be more sure that we're sometimes morally responsible, I think he does. I mean, he's a theist. I take it that's why. At least one of the central reasons why he thinks he has most reason. So if you think you have a really strong reason for theism, then that might give you stronger reason for the claim that we're morally responsible than that PAP is true or that Beta is valid.
Yeah. But we got, okay. I don't know. I mean, we can't go too far into this. But I do think, so I think, although there are differences between the analogy that I gave and Van Inwet, the analogy of the utilitarian, I think there are similarities as well in that there's a dialectical infelicity, in my view, in the view of just sticking with the idea that, well, let's say utilitarianism is the correct moral theory, and it says, and it works quite well in the real world and worlds like the real world. But then I admit, if I, let's say I'm a utilitarian, I admit that in a world very unlike us, our world, my own theory would tell me that I really have to and I ought to convict an innocent person or break a promise or, you know, torture someone. But that's really, you know, well, I know, see, the utilitarian is going to further say, this is complicates it a little further, he's going to say, look, if you think about it carefully enough, if the world's different enough to make it the case that it would maximize utility to convict an innocent person or torture someone, that really is the right thing to do. I mean, you're thinking more in terms of our world and similar worlds, and it's wrong in our world or similar, but it really would be the right thing in that other world. So it's complicated. But I still think, okay, so I don't know if I should place a lot of weight on the analogy, but I think there's something similar. But what I
the example would be better if the utilitarian were to give up his utilitarianism at that point.
Yes. That okay. That's good. That's a nice point.
Yeah, sure,
That's a good point. That's really probably what I should have been saying. So what if the utilitarian says, "I am a utilitarian," and really defends it very vigorously, but says, "I admit that if empirical circumstances were very different, then I would give up, you know, such that it would be the right thing to do, then I would give up my utilitarianism." I mean, maybe that's the thing to do. Like, maybe again, maybe you could defend that and say, maybe he or she would say, look, utilitarianism is built for worlds like ours. And if you show me a world that's so different that it really would be the case that...
Or to make it even more analogous, I mean, because... utilitarians usually don't believe in a specific time frame. They say it should take all consequences into account, ideally.
Yes.
So imagine that scientists in our actual world find out, I have no idea how they would find out this, but suppose they somehow find out that if I were to torture an innocent person here in this world, some kind of weird chain of events would unroll and eventually maximum happiness would be produced like 100 years from now.
Yeah, it's complicated.
Okay, so if a utilitarian says that if scientists were to find that out, I would stop being a utilitarian and become a Kantian instead.
Yeah.
Okay, that's the best analogy, I think.
Yes, and that does seem...
And that seems dishonest somehow.
It's suspicious because the person's willing to go to the mat for this ethical proposition until push comes to shove and say, well, it wasn't really that important.
Yeah, you should
and
write
up. That's what's
that's cool.
odd about Van Inwagen's position. But so Yishai's point was that he's not rationally criticizable given the credence that he assigns to these propositions.
Yeah, but I think he
but
is rationally criticizable.
That those levels of credence are themselves questionable or odd from somebody's perspective.
You should write a paper going to the mat or something. Anyway, bad joke. what I think, so I try in this recent paper that's forthcoming in a volume edited by Kevin Timpe and Dan Speak on the relationship between libertarianism and theism. But so I try and say more about what I think the problem for metaphysical flip-flopping is. Why is Van Inwagen in a dialectically infelicitous position? This is the idea, I think, roughly is. There's a song, a rock song, called Bringing It All Home, or at least that's the refrain. Do you know what the group is? I forget it, but anyway, Bringing It All Home. And the idea is, why not bring compatibilism home? Now, let me just explain. So what Van Inwagen has to say is, I really think that beta, or the principle of transfer of powerlessness, this modal principle in some form or another, is a valid principle. It's very plausible, and he gives all sorts of reasons for thinking that. But he does say, look, in the unlikely, very unlikely event that I'm convinced that determinism is true, I would give up beta. So now, but now think of this a little bit. Why, just this is what I invite you to think. In that circumstance, admittedly very unlikely, in which Van Inwagen would give up beta, would he be just giving it up to save his theory? That would seem ad hoc and problematic. What I think he really has to say is, no, I think what I would do is reevaluate, and I would find that there's some evidence on the basis of which I would reject beta, that there's some reason to reject beta. I would give it more credence or more weight if I were to discover that determinism is true. In other words, what he would say is, in the very, and we'll end in a second, but in the very unlikely scenario in which I'm convinced that determinism is true, I would reevaluate beta, and I would, in that circumstance, presumably find that there's some good reason to reject beta. My question is, why not, if that's right, then that evidence exists even now, even in the actual world. I mean, it doesn't change. I mean, if there really is evidence in that other scenario, the scenario in which determinism is true, to think that beta should be rejected, then that, why not bring it home? Bring it home to the real, to the actual world. So Van Inwagen, in my view, really should be a compatibilist. I mean, he should reject beta in the actual world. I mean, that's really where I think he's problematic. I mean, in other words, he's rationally criticizable because either he would be giving up a basic metaphysical principle just to save his conclusion, just to protect his conclusion, and that's criticizable from a rational point of view, or he's failing to bring it home, which is also rationally criticizable. Okay, and let's be really quick, because I think we're at our coffee break time, but yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, so maybe you're convincing me to some extent.
That's the most you can ever hope for.
Yeah. So
now
maybe,
I can retire, Dan.
So maybe if these sort of metaphysical theses about, in particular, compatibilism and incompatibilism are necessarily true, if true at all, and if Van Inwagen is willing to admit that it's possible that compatibilism is true, maybe he should.
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking. Like, why?
Or at least epistemically possible or something like
that. Yeah, so if you think it's possible.
It's not like compatibilism might be true in that world, but not in this world.
Yeah,
right?
How could
so it's
that
not
be?
Supposed to be something that's relative to the contingent features of the world.
Yeah. No, I mean, I think this is a really interesting dialectic, and you know, more can be said, I'm sure. But yeah, if you think. Because compatibilism just. It just says there's a scenario, it may not be this one, in which determinism is true and we're free. Now, if Van Inwagen's willing to say, look, in the very unlikely circumstance in which I'm convinced determinism is true, I'd give up beta, then it does seem that he should be a compatibilist, because he thinks there's some circumstance in which, you know, but anyway, let's have our coffee break. When we get back, we'll look at other versions of the consequence. Okay.